Mother to Son by Langston Hughes. Well, son, I'll tell you, life for me ain't been no crystal stair. It had tacks in it, and obstacles, and boards torn up, and places where there just ain't been no carpet, bare. But all the time, I've been climbing, I've been turning corners, reaching landings, and sometimes go in places where there just ain't been no light. So son, don't you fall back. Don't you sit down on those steps because you find it's kind of hard. Because son, I've been climbing and life for me ain't been no crystal stair.
So we are the morning and afternoon workshop, the capoeira workshop. And for what you guys know about capoeira, it's a Brazilian martial art. I played it for a long time when I lived in Hawaii. And we were really lucky to have an instructor come up from New Haven today and teach us all a routine. Most of us have never done this before. We learned it in an hour. So bear with us, but we had a lot of fun, and I hope you enjoy.
Lele Makulele, boa noite pra você. Makulele, boa noite pra você.
Lele Makulele,
boa noite pra você.
Makulele,
boa noite pra você.
Olha aqui meu camarada, presta muita atenção. Isso aqui é o candês, não é brincadeira não. Lele Makulele,
boa noite pra você.
Makulele,
boa noite pra você.
O facão bateu em cima, houve muita vibração. Faísca pra todo lado, é o candeias, meu irmão. Lele Makulele,
boa noite pra você.
Makulele,
boa noite pra você.
E menino, toma cuidado para não se machucar. Isso é jogo de facão, é cultura popular. Lele Makulele,
boa noite pra você.
Makulele,
boa noite pra você.
Eu cortava cana madura para no engenho moer, pra fazer a rapadura para eu sobreviver. Lele Makulele,
boa noite pra você.
Makulele,
boa noite pra você.
Eu quero ver você bater, bater os paus pra dançar Makulele.
Eu quero ver você bater, bater os paus pra dançar Makulele.
Eu quero ver você bater, bater os paus pra dançar Makulele.
Eu quero ver você bater, bater os paus pra dançar Makulele.
Gira, gira, gira a roda, bate os paus que eu quero ver. Gira, gira, gira a roda pra dançar Makulele.
Gira, gira, gira a roda, bate os paus que eu quero ver. Gira, gira, gira a roda pra dançar Makulele.
Gira, gira, gira a roda, bate os paus que eu quero ver. Gira, gira, gira a roda pra dançar Makulele.
Gira, gira, gira a roda, bate os paus que eu quero ver. Gira, gira, gira a roda pra dançar Makulele.
Eu quero ver você bater, bater os paus pra dançar Makulele.
Eu quero ver você bater, bater os paus pra dançar Makulele.
Eu quero ver você bater, bater os paus pra dançar Makulele.
Eu quero ver você bater, bater os paus pra dançar Makulele.
Gira, gira, gira a roda, bate os paus que eu quero ver. Gira, gira, gira a roda pra dançar Makulele.
Gira, gira, gira a roda, bate os paus que eu quero ver. Gira, gira, gira a roda pra dançar Makulele.
Gira, gira, gira a roda, bate os paus que eu quero ver. Gira, gira, gira a roda pra dançar Makulele.
Gira, gira, gira a roda pra dançar Makulele.
Eu vim na tua aldeia aqui.
Hi, I'm Maddie, and I'm a four-year senior.
Hi, I'm Michelle, and I'm also a four-year senior.
Many of you might not know this, but me and Michelle were roommates our freshman year.
That first day of freshman year, as I looked around our tiny room,
I said, "Hi, Michelle, I'm Maddie. I'm so excited to meet you. We're going to have the best year ever. It's going to be so much fun. I'm so excited. I just can't wait."
I was startled. Maddie stared at me with her eyes wide open, clearly super excited, and all I could mumble back was, "Hi."
I was actually really intimidated as well. Michelle had so much luggage, it took up the whole room.
And I was intimidated by Maddie, as I wondered, were all the freshman girls gonna be this tall?
Michelle would realize that neither of our heights are that average.
I'm 5'2".
I'm 5'10 on a short day.
And the size difference didn't really matter.
Until we realized one thing.
We couldn't share shoes.
Just tried to do that together.
I mean, Maddie's feet weren't that much bigger.
Yeah, Michelle's feet were only 3 sizes smaller. It's no big deal. We could have fit.
Actually, our height difference did pose another small problem.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Maddie would sometimes come back to our room a little upset.
Usually about my latest boy drama.
And she would sit on my lap.
And Michelle would try to comfort me the best she could while trying not to suffocate underneath me.
Maddie and I had our differences.
I like to wake up a minimum of 30 minutes before class.
I wouldn't wake up until 5 minutes before class.
I'm kind of outgoing.
I was a lot shyer.
Michelle would encourage me to not give up on my geometry homework.
Maddie would try with all her might to get me to go to scene.
Still, we managed to grow closer.
We bonded over sour gummy worms and our favorite movie, Rio.
Many of our nights were spent with Mackenzie Erdman on Charlotte Masucci's famous red couch, watching movies, eating, and taking pictures on photo booth.
Our decor above the couch included the latest trend, Spider-Man stickers and silly bands.
It was really chic. Michelle and I were also doubles partners on the JV tennis team that year.
We were at the dead bottom of the ladder, but we knew we were really the best players on the team.
Not really. Most of our matches consisted of horribly played points, plenty of unbelievably bad shots, and a lot of laughter.
Freshman year was definitely a roller coaster, but I think we're both glad we got to live it together.
We learned so much from each other and made such wonderful and hilarious memories.
We're still the same buds we were freshman year.
You'll definitely catch us at the movies when Rio 2 comes out this spring.
First, cast the stone, Mr. Jailer. Hello, everyone. My name's Jimmy. This is my brother from Zimbabwe, Ezra. We're going to be playing some African drums called djembe. And djembe actually translates to gather in peace.
So these drums were used to gather people around for meetings in Africa.
I'm Ms. Ryan. Benny was my temporary advisee, and I had him in my 9th grade approaches to history class. Over the years, I've discovered that temporary advisees like to pick somebody they feel connected to, so they either stick with their advisor or find somebody that they do. However, in Benny's case...
Or he might be simply too lazy to change. Speaking of approaches to history, I still remember vividly when Mrs. Ryan asked our class to rank liberty, equality, and fraternity. I thought, this teacher must be a staunch conservative Republican. But over the years, after many impromptu conversations on history and politics, I've discovered that she always has a moderate and reasonable opinion.
Benny, you're so smart. You know me so well. We have enjoyed our conversations over the years, and I love having someone to talk to about history and politics. Benny has been a really great and easy advisee.
Wait, you draw some such simplistic conclusions. Remember the time you called me the pain in the something?
Oh, yeah. All right, that's true, but I feel very lucky that we've gotten to know each other so well, despite the fact that you are a pain in the ass.
Anyways, I think we do have many differences, but we have also discovered many similarities.
Thank you.
Ready? Yeah.
Hiding in those weak and drunken hearts, I guess you kissed the girls and made them cry, those hard-faced queens of misadventure. God knows what is hiding in those weak and sunken eyes, a fiery throng of muted angels giving love but getting nothing back. Oh, people of the people, and if you're homesick, give me your hand and I'll hold it. People, help the people, nothing will drag you down. Oh, and if I had a brain, oh, and if I had a brain, I'd be bold as a stone and rich as a fool that turned all those good hearts away.
God knows what is hiding in the world of little consequence, inside the tears, behind the lights, a thousand slowly dying suns.
that weak and drunken hearts. I guess the loneliness came knocking. No one needs to be alone. No, save me, people, help the people. And if you're homesick, give me your hand and I'll hold it. People, help the people. Nothing will drag you down. Oh, and if I had a brain. Oh, and if I had a brain. I'd be cold as a stone and rich as the fool that turned all those good hearts away. Nah, nah.
Entitled The Majority. Do you see my hair? In its natural form, it's too hard to rake through, but I get relaxers to make it straight, but apparently that means I want to be white. Do you see my eyes? Mine are dark brown, but there are people of my ethnicity with green eyes, but that doesn't necessarily make them mixed. Do you see my skin? The pigments of my skin has these pigments because that is what was needed to survive in Africa. But there are people who are lighter and darker than me, but that doesn't make them any less black. F team light skin, F team dark skin, we are all the same. When I go home, people tell me I speak white, and here people tell me I speak black, but how can I speak a color? You need to realize that your microaggressive comments hurt. Your, so where are you really from? Your, so what are you? Your snide comments about my race, your assumption that I'm poor, your assumption that just because I'm the only black student in class that I can speak for my entire race. You wanna know where I'm from? I'm from New Jersey. You wanna know what I am? I'm African American with ancestry in the South. I don't care about your comments because I am proud to be black, and not all black people are poor. My parents have been paying for me to go to private schools my entire life, and teachers, just because I'm the only black student in class does not mean I speak for my entire race. So stop questioning me about welfare and weave. Stop looking at me every time slavery is brought up in the classroom. Stop treating me like a minority because it's predicted that by 2050, I will be the majority, and you will see how I felt all these years. This is not meant to be a threat. This is meant to educate you on how you've been treating people of my ethnicity or how we've been treating each other, because we all deserve equality, even if it takes forever to get there. So the next time you think of making a microaggressive comment, remember that soon you'll be in my shoes. And how would you feel if I treated you that way?
Thank you. people, can you feel it? Murder's everywhere. People, can you hear it? Song is in the air. We're at a revolution. Well, don't you know we're right? People want to fight. People, can you feel it? Help is everywhere. People, can you feel it? Help is everywhere. People, can you feel it? Love is everywhere. People, can you feel it? Love is everywhere. People, can you feel it? Love is everywhere. Love is everywhere. Love is everywhere. Love is everywhere. Love is everywhere.
Hi, Queen.
Hey, buddy.
What's up, buddy? I started my 23-hour journey to America not knowing what to expect.
When I heard I was about to have an older brother from Zimbabwe, I wasn't sure how I felt about this new addition to my family.
As I pulled into their driveway, a wave of people came out of their front door to greet me.
I remember him rolling up in Suburban with Mr. Blomberg, decked out in all blue with a big smile on his face.
Within minutes of meeting them, all my anxiety about where they were going to get along vanished.
At first glance, our only commonality was that we both played soccer. He was pretty unbelievable. I was okay.
Yeah, he was okay. My first experience of chaff was when the dynamic duo of Sam Stamos and Tommy Robichaud came to visit Queen.
I was unsure of how Ezra was going to relate with two of the weirdest people at Taft.
As I watched Sam Stamos and Tommy Robichaud get out of their broken car, I was like, oh my God, who are these people?
By the time I had gone to the bathroom and come back, I found Tommy, Sam, and Ezra hanging out in the guest house as if they'd been friends forever.
Little did I know I was partying with the king of Taft and his little minion, Sam Stamos.
Then in the middle of the night, Tommy felt like going swimming, so naturally we all jumped in. The only problem was...
I can't swim.
No problem. We just had to find a way to make him float.
They strapped a life jacket on me, floaties on my arms and legs.
Tommy swore he could teach him to swim, but I didn't see it happening.
I couldn't imagine the fat Tommy teaching me how to swim. While I thought I was going to be with Queen for the soccer season, to my amazement, they kept inviting me to their family events.
3 months later, we were all sitting around the Christmas tree, passing around gifts as if he was just another kid in the family. While he is 2 years older than me, he is more like a little brother to me.
Oh, but I remember the Christmas card.
Yeah, Ezra even made it onto the family Christmas card.
Thank you, guys.
Gosh, how do I follow that up? Okay, you guys might not know me. My name is Marissa. I'm a freshman. And I'd like to dance for you. Every song in Hawaii has a story behind it. Every mele has somebody who lived behind, or somebody in fiction who lived behind. The story that I want to tell you today is about a beautiful young woman named La'ie Kawai, who was trapped on a mountain, on a pali, on a cliff. But she managed to escape, and she grew into a beautiful young woman. And I want to dedicate this song to my mom, because not only is it her birthday, she also helped me grow into this young, into the person that I am, and she gave me the opportunity to come to Taft, and for that, I'm forever grateful.
Oh. With his back against the San Francisco traffic, on the bridge's side that faces towards the jail, setting out to join a demographic, he hoists his first leg up over the rail. A phone call's made, police cars show up quickly. The sergeant slams his passenger door. He says, "Hey son, why don't you talk through this with me? Just tell me what you're doing it for." Well, it's a little bit of everything. It's the mountains, it's the fall. It's the news at 6 o'clock. It's the death of my first dog. It's the angels up above me. It's a song that they don't sing. It's a little bit of everything. There's an older man who stands in a buffet line. He is smiling and he's holding out his plate. And the further he looks back into his timeline, that hard road always led him to today, making up for when his bright future had left him, making up for the fact his only son is gone, and letting everything at once his server asks him, "Have you figured out yet what it is you want?" "I want a little bit of everything. The biscuits and the beans. Whatever helps me to forget about the things that brought me to my knees. So pile on those mashed potatoes and an extra chicken wing. I'm having a little bit of everything." Somewhere a pretty girl is writing invitations to a wedding she has scheduled for the fall. Her man says, "Baby, can I make an observation? You don't seem to be having any fun at all." She said, "You just worry about your groomsmen and your shirt size. Rest assured that this is making me feel good. I think that love is so much easier than you realize. If you can give yourself to someone, then you should. 'Cause it's a little bit of everything. The way you joke, the way you wake. It is getting up before you so I can watch you as you wake. So on that day in late September, it's not some stupid little ring. I'm getting a little bit of everything. And it's a little bit of everything. It's the matador and the bull. It's the suggested daily dosage. It's the red moon when it's full. All these psychics and these doctors, they're all right and they're all wrong. It's like trying to make out every word when they should simply hum along. It's not some message written in the dark or some truth that no one sees. It's a little bit of everything.
Johnny, why were we asked to be an odd couple?
Well, aren't all odd couples supposed to have, I don't know how to put this, glaring differences? I mean, I'm short and you're really tall.
Yeah, well, maybe that's a part of it, but there have to be a lot of other differences that we're not seeing.
Oh, I have an iPhone 5. You have an iPhone 5S.
Yeah, there's one. And you like Mumford & Sons, and I like Of Monsters & Men.
I'm white with brown hair, and you're white with blonde hair. Except for your eyebrows, they're brown.
Yeah, I mean, that's another. I mean, I like skiing, and you like surfing or wakeboarding or waterboarding.
Not waterboarding, that's torture. Skimboarding?
Yeah, that's the one.
I'm a faculty kid, and you're not.
We're so different. Wait, those aren't actually real differences.
Should we just go?
No, come on, no turning back now.
But that's not fair. You're really good at improv and acting and all that, and I'm not.
Well, I mean, that may be true, but you've got the whole sports thing working. I mean, like, when's the last time you saw me wearing shorts?
Okay. I'm feeling better now.
You sure? You got this?
Yep. Oh, here's another. You're into math and science.
Yeah, and you like English and history.
So we do have some pretty fundamental differences, I guess. I never really thought about that. It's like we tend to avoid them or something.
Yeah, I guess it's just easier and less risky. I mean, I'd have been embarrassed to reveal that I was in AB Calc my freshman year.
Yeah, and I probably wouldn't have said that I like reading for fun.
You want to keep that one to yourself, champ.
Probably a good idea.
I mean, maybe they asked us up here so we realize how different we actually are. I don't mean the, like, Telluride, Colorado versus the Watertown, Connecticut thing, although that is something that differentiates us.
No, I know what you mean. Like, sometimes great friends need to be reminded of their difference in order to celebrate them.
So true.
And being reminded of our differences even allow us to share our passions and discover things we would have never otherwise found.
Johnny, I like to read, too.
David Sedaris?
Yeah.
Maybe two white kids who love extreme sports, The Office, and reading can be an odd couple.
Yeah, and maybe the perceived definition of an odd couple needs to be fixed. I mean, it has a lot more to do with unique passions and willingness to share them than geography and skin color, but I am from Colorado.
Yeah, we all know.
All right, here's another one. I'm a Libra, and you're a Capricorn.
Nope, we're done.
People get ready, there's a train in Jordan. It's picking up passengers from coast to coast. All you need is faith to hear the diesel humming. There's room for all amongst love the most. They say we stand for nothing. There's no way we ever could. And we see everything that's going wrong with the world and those who lead it. We just feel like we don't have the means to rise above and beat it. So we keep waiting. Waiting on the world to change. We keep waiting.
Dude, are you sure you want to do this? We can just walk off the stage right now if you want.
Hey guys, I don't know whether you know this about Fiordi and I, but I like to sing and he likes to play the guitar, so I'm gonna sing for you.
You ready? We're just kidding, we're not gonna sing, guys. Come on, guys. We're not gonna sing, we're awful.
I cannot sing.
Yeah, we'll stick to soccer, okay?
Yeah. So the first time I met Fiordi, it was in the fall during preseason. I was new. I did not know anyone. So as usual, I introduced myself to him. So I said, hey, I'm Porus, and I'm from India, and I'm going to be a junior this year. And he said, I'm Fiordi, like it's a common name or something. And I'm also going to be a junior. So I thought to myself, okay, he's the guy with the weird name.
It's true, everyone thinks I have a weird name, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah. So then I asked him where he was from, and he said,
I am originally from Albania, but I lived in Greece for 13 years, and now I live in Waterbury.
That was weird again, so. Anyway, he was a day student, so I thought I wouldn't be seeing much of him. But I was wrong. Every time I went to my room after a long day and wanted to relax on my couch, Fiordi would be lying down, listening to music. He thought we had become friends or something.
Well, whatever it was, whether if we were friends or not, if it wasn't for soccer, we would not have become friends. The first time I heard the guys talking about this Indian kid coming to Taft, I imagined a 6'4" gigantic person with muscles. Instead, I met this guy.
I'm 5'7".
Well, that's one side of the story, guys. I did everything for Porus. As I was sitting on his couch one day, he commanded me to take his laundry back to my house and do it for him.
He thinks I talk like that.
Who doesn't think you talk like that? Other than the fact that he thinks he doesn't have an accent, he also thinks his first language is English.
Yes. I speak English at home.
Okay. Anyways, I had no choice but to take his laundry at my house and do it for him because he goes to the gym and he works out, and I was afraid I was going to get beat up by this scrawny kid.
Shut up, Macklemore.
All right. All right, stop causing a scene. No need for that.
Okay, so moving on, we decided I was going to spend winter break with him.
We?
Yeah.
We did not decide anything at all, actually. I was just getting sick and tired of your accent, so I just agreed. All jokes aside, guys, while Porus was over, I saw a different side of him. He was kind, he was respectful to some extent. He was funny, and my family actually really liked him. My mom even referred to him as her third son when they Skyped with his father. I found that kind of odd, actually, because I knew all the flaws Porus had. He's lazy, he's indecisive, he's boring, sassy, judgmental.
Stop. I saw another side of you too, okay? Even though you're a good son, you're a good host to some extent, funny to some, and have the biggest calves in the world. You had the most annoying habit of constantly being on your cell phone.
Okay, I admit it. I was on my phone a lot.
Ms. Dinolfo?
but still. Porus' day was so much fun. I'm glad he didn't fly back to India, which I'm sure he would have if he had the chance. He FaceTimed with his family, and I could see how much he missed them and he loved them. Porus is actually a really sweet guy. He just doesn't like to show it. He's shy and humble. He's hard.
Sorry.
He's. He is, he's very hardworking, even if I said he's lazy. But who isn't in the end of the day? He enjoys the simple things in life, such as good homemade food, good company, and sleep. He loves to sleep.
Jody's a nice guy, too.
When Sam first came to Taft, no one could guess his heritage.
Especially Tommy.
Mexican?
No.
Eastern European?
No.
Middle Eastern?
You got it.
Really?
No.
Turns out, Sam is half Chinese, a quarter Italian, and a quarter Greek. Little known fact, and this is true, his full last name is Stamatopoulos.
And Tommy is 100% Cherokee.
1/16.
Anyway, this is a story of how we became friends, traveled to a far corner of the globe, and learned something about the value of difference.
Wow, Sam, that was surprisingly well said.
I remember when I first saw Tommy. He was dressed like Abe Lincoln, top hat and all.
And Sam, well, Sam looked different.
This is how we became friends.
It was sophomore year, the night before the final history paper was due.
Specifically, it was 2:30 a.m., and neither Tommy nor I had started our history papers. It was going to be a long night.
I headed for the T to get to work. From the end of the hall, I saw a strange, quivering, light blue blob. It was Sam, wrapped in a Snuggie, trembling with fear.
I had one sentence written. Tommy sat down next to me and laughed. Then I laughed. Then we cried. Then... Then we wrote the papers, and by 6 a.m., I headed for bed, praying that I had created something halfway literate.
On his way, Sam threw me the Snuggie and some Nutter Butters, Fat Tommy, Ezra, and said one of the sappiest things I've ever heard.
A friend should never be left out in the cold.
A legacy pair was born.
Over the next 2 years, Tommy and I became closer friends. We learned a lot about each other's lives.
I've stayed at Sam's house.
I text Tommy's mom.
I've been yelled at by Sam's brother.
I put Fred in a headlock, and Tennant, and Tommy.
Over the span of our friendship, Sam and I have had many, many, many disagreements.
But somehow we've remained friends.
When I analyze this, which believe me, I do, I realize that we've stayed friends in spite of all of our differences because of humor. We make each other laugh.
Last summer, we decided to go on a service trip.
We didn't know where we should go.
Then I saw a tag on my sweater vest that said, "Made in Cambodia."
So, after some research, that's where we went.
Cambodia was a place that was different for both of us.
Even though, not so long ago, I might have guessed that Sam was Cambodian.
Nope.
Wherever we went in Cambodia, we met challenges and differences with humor. Whether that meant trying to teach English to children who could not communicate with us at all.
Or not being allowed to flush toilet paper down our toilet.
Waiting 3 hours on a chicken farm for the Cambodian teacher we worked for to arrive on his moped.
Or sitting for hours on end in darkness after a little Cambodian boy had cut our power lines.
Watching a midget jump on Sam at a midget-haunted house. Those are a big deal there.
Or peeing in a bucket on a moving bus.
We laughed through it all with everyone we met.
And that made it an amazing experience.
As we begin our last semester at this place, Sam and I often think about how Taft has brought us two very different people together.
We're grateful for that.
No, don't kiss me. No.
Thank you.
Million Man March poem by Maya Angelou. Under a dead blue sky on a distant beach, I was dragged by my braids just beyond your reach. Your hands were tied and your mouth was bound and you couldn't even call out my name. You were helpless and so was I, but unfortunately throughout history, you've worn a badge of shame. I say, the night has been long, the wound has been deep, the pit has been dark and the walls have been steep, but today, voices of old spirits sound, speaking to us in worlds profound. Across the years, across the centuries, across the oceans and across the seas, they say, draw near to one another, save your race. You have been paid for in a distant place. The ancestors remind us how slavery's chains have paid for our freedom again and again. The night has been long. The pit has been deep. The night has been dark and the walls have been steep. The hells that we've lived through and lived through still have sharpened our senses and toughened our will. The night has been dark this morning. I look through your anguish right down to your soul. I know with each other we can make ourselves whole. I look past your posture and past your disguise and I see your love for family in your big brown eyes. So I say clap hands and let's join together in the meeting grounds. I say clap hands and let's treat each other with love. I say clap hands and let's get from this low road of indifference. Clap hands, let us come together and reveal our hearts. Let us come together and revise our souls. Let us come together and cleanse our spirits. Clap hands, let's stop this preening and stop impostering our own history. Clap hands, let's bring the spirits back from the ledge. Clap hands, let's invite joy into our conversation. Courtesy into our bedrooms, gentleness into our kitchen, care into our nursery. The ancestors remind us, despite a history of pain, we are going on people who will rise again. And still, we rise.
Oh, let us turn our thoughts today to Martin Luther King and recognize that there are ties between us, all men and women living on the earth, ties of hope and love, sister and brotherhood.